Hello. So I got a call at 2 o'clock yesterday afternoon to come and talk to you guys. So this is kind of where I was. Luckily, I talk about security and I work in the security field. That's not me, is it? Okay. I have a consultancy here in Wisconsin, of course, like many of you, and we have an online service that where we manage and update and keep track of all your websites. Originally was a Joomla project, and as of Christmas Day, became also a WordPress project. So we see a lot of security vulnerabilities. We think a lot about why your website might be vulnerable, and we try and think about it in a holistic way. We're not a company that's going to solve your hacked websites. That's not our business. What we try and do is teach you and help you with best practices so that your website doesn't get hacked or is so uninteresting that hackers go past you. That's actually one of, I think, the best, most easiest ways to keep your site safe. So what we're going to do is look at kind of a holistic approach, but I wanted to back out a little and talk a little bit about the Panama Papers. And this was a really big news item about 10 months ago. And for those of you who don't know, it was all centered around this South American legal firm called Mossack and Fonseca. And their job was to basically set up tax havens overseas for the world's rich and famous and elite and powerful. So how many of you here invest your money in a tax haven overseas? How would you do it, right? Most people don't have any way to do that. Even if you went on vacation to a country that you might associate with being a tax haven, what would you do when you got there? My business partners are in Switzerland, actually. I have quite good access to something that has been traditionally considered a tax haven. But what would I do? I have no idea. Why? It's secret, right? It's hidden. It's this underworld where they don't want, they're like your website in a way. They don't want attention from anybody. They want to do the little thing, hide their money, not pay taxes, and hopefully nobody notices. Well, the internet doesn't like that, of course. The internet hates secrets. And the story broke last year that all of these people around the world were involved in this giant, tax evasion by alleged tax evasion, I should say. If I forget to say alleged, just like insert it in your mind for me. So the prime minister of Iceland stepped down. The current president of Argentina has been under investigation for 10 months. Tony Blair, the former prime minister of the UK, was implicated. Now he didn't stick around long enough probably to get in that much trouble. In total, over 150 investigations across 79 countries. I think to date, $150 million of uncollected taxes have been recovered. This has been a massive, massive security breach. The largest ever, 146 million files, 2.6 terabytes of data was stolen. And then a team of 400 journalists around the world got together and started putting this information out. And it took so many people because there was so much, as you can see, information to go through. And that's what led to this huge, massive, giant data breach and a lot of egg on a lot of people's faces. Probably a win for governments around the world. But why did this happen? Okay? We can look to something that you guys are all familiar with. Everyone here uses WordPress, which I think is most of you. And we can just look right at how frequently people around the world who use WordPress update WordPress. So this is a website security report from a company called Sucuri, which some of you may know, may use. And they produce a quarterly report of hacked websites that they, as their business, fix on other people's behalfs. And in Q3 2016, that's this green bar here. 74% of the hacked websites that came through their door were WordPress related. 17% Joomla, and then below that, you know, drops to the single-digit percentages. So that's their just analysis of how many hacked websites there are. You know, essentially, 3 in every 4, right? It's quite high. Missed the button there. Here we go. Oh, sorry. And then if you break that down and you look at out-of-date core software, you see 61% of their hacked sites had outdated WordPress core files. Joomla, 84%. Look at Magento. 94% of Magento installs in their hacked analysis were out of date. Right? It's pretty.
How much was WordPress?
61% Q3 2016. This is available online, by the way. You can find it at sucuri.com, I think. And yesterday, did anyone notice this came out yesterday morning, right? You all got your update notification? Who here got an update notification last night for, right? So if you have anything, if you have WordPress greater than version 3.7, should be basically auto-updating the core, and you're getting your email. So it was a very timely update for this talk, so I guess I'll thank WordPress for that. Right, so they made that change in WordPress to protect us, right? And to protect these, you know, not just the people who are running legit businesses, but also protecting the people who are, you know, running these scams around the world, botnets, you know, really terrible advertising sites that you run across all the time. If you look deeper, it's not just the core software that has trouble, but if you look at all the vulnerabilities in WordPress, the top 18% were caused by just three plugins out of date, okay? I've actually never heard of Tim Thumb. Does anyone here use that? Is that popular, Tim Thumb? Okay, good. Gravity Forms, you know, probably the most popular forms, right? At least in the premium level. And then RevSlider. Who's using RevSlider here? One, two. Okay, so presumably you're not using anything below version 3.095, I think. Is that where we are? Right. So anything less than that has a vulnerability. And this is a captured screenshot from, this is the Monsec Fonseca website, and they were running this really old version of RevSlider. No one knows if that was a source of the hack that caused all that international kerfuffle, but clearly this is a major problem, okay, and it can affect anybody. And I would say that in my experience, the core, you can see in the news, oh, this site on this CMS was out, you know, was a security problem. Often the core takes the, you know, bad credit for that, those kinds of things, but most often it's the plugins, especially when you might have 10, 20, 50 plugins on your site. Think of all the little things you might install, especially on large sites. But it's not just the embarrassment of having your data exposed. The big trend these days is ransomware. If you haven't heard of that, that's where your PC or your network of PCs have all their data encrypted, meaning that you can't access it anymore. And you see something like this when you turn on your computer, and it's a screen that says, we've encrypted everything, and if you want access, please buy these bitcoins, which are anonymous and untraceable, and send them to us, and then we'll unlock your system. Okay? So, $500, you know, would you do that for your business? Probably. $10,000, $20,000, $100,000, you know. As the companies get bigger, these ransoms get higher. And what's interesting is a large botnet has recently been, basically, it's kind of like a modified phishing attack. The website gets infected with something that redirects people to a site where they install. It actually takes advantage of a browser insecurity and installs, for better or worse, lack of a better term, a rootkit on your computer, and that leads to this kind of ransom situation. So. Yeah, and by the way, just if you haven't been following, I've kind of been linking down here as appropriate if you want to follow up on some of these things. So website security may not just affect how private your data is or your reputation with your clients or within your area, but it can, you know, really have serious effects on very, you know, a large number of people. You can imagine how many people might be infected their personal PCs by visiting your website that's hacked. Okay, it's a serious problem. So kind of, is everyone like this right now? That's kind of... Okay, well, the news isn't all bad, right? We've got to set up a really good straw man so the finish is good. What I want to talk to you about today are the way we look at security and trying to prevent all those nasty, crazy things that happen, or even the little things that are, you know, just painful. Have you ever had a low-level hack, maybe a little slight defacement somewhere, and it keeps coming back, and you can't figure it out, and oh, now it's another 2 hours of my day? Okay, sometimes it can be as small as that, but it can really have a big effect on your productivity, okay, and your confidence, frankly. You want to be able to take care of those things, but mostly prevent them if possible. So we're going to talk about the ways that we look at that, and we look at it in this pyramidal structure you see here, where your agency is at the base of the pyramid. The infrastructure you have, the server and services that you use are in the mid-tier, and then the very kind of last user-facing error, your application layer, is kind of the top of the pyramid. So we're just going to process through those. There's quite a bit there. I know I've got, well, I don't have a clock in front of me, so if I'm running late, someone please tell me. But we're going to start at the bottom and talk about your agency. And this is, I think, an area where, especially if you have a smaller business, maybe you have a sole proprietorship, or a young business that you're so busy working and getting everything working and getting your clients and sales and everything else that it can be easy to overlook some of these policies. But in our experience, what we're going to tell you, it's easier to implement them at the early stage because then you can scale them as you go instead of trying to retroactively fit those changes to a kind of a set process you might build. So password security, of course you need a strong password. That's actually not the main topic here. When we talk about password security at the agency level, we're talking about how do you manage your passwords? How do you keep track of them on behalf of your clients and third parties that have hired you to work for them? How do you share them safely and securely among the members of your team? And that includes the closest team, the people in your office or down the hall, but also maybe some remote characters you have on your team. Maybe some outsourcing people who live in other places, or people who work from home. Okay, those are super important things to have in your agency that everyone understands how to use them, they use them properly and consistently for everyone's benefit. And so there are lots of password managers. I mean, 5 years ago, this would have been a different conversation, but you have your choice these days. A lot of people use LastPass personally. They have a team version, as does 1Password. It's another one that I really like for the enterprise level, only out of price, really. It's an excellent piece of software. And this is called Team Password Manager. I think you can just read it at the top there. Really also super good. And the advantage that Team Password Manager has to some of the more traditional ones is really super good control over ACL or access for different groups to different pieces of infrastructure and secure, not just passwords, secure notes, confidential agreements, those sort of things. So figure out what makes sense for your password policy and adopt the workflow that's going to give your client security but let you do your work also in an efficient way and work generally as a team. Strong passwords, I mentioned it. We all know we need strong passwords. Unique password for every site, every service on every site. Don't duplicate them ever. And I always like to not know what my passwords are, ever. So the only thing that lets me, I only know 1Password, the master password. For those of you who have not used them, you have a master password to get access to everything. That's the only one you truly need to remember. Put that in your safe deposit box on a piece of paper and remember it well. Everything else, when I log into any services, it's just copy-paste, and you're copy-pasting a bunch of asterisks, and then you paste it in. I have no idea what it was. It was randomly generated. I pasted it blindly, and we go from there, okay? There are lots of places where you can generate passwords. I recommend you so many things on Google, obviously. I'm not going to replicate them here. Find the one you like on Google. Set up what that policy is. How long is it? How much complexity? How often does it change? Right? So at our firm, we do annual password replacements. So we have a password day. And that day is just everyone takes, one of our properties, and they're responsible for changing all the passwords. Okay? Because that's done in one place, it's easy then when people go back to use it. Okay? Having the same password for 10 years, not so great. Changing it every 3 months, like my bank, oh, I hate that, it's so bad. But it's important to obviously change them regularly, so make sure you keep track of that. And this password policy you're making, the security policy at your agency, it applies to everyone, right? Not just the boss, so not just the IT guys. It's really something we feel at our agency that needs to be a holistic approach. Everyone needs to buy in, and everyone needs to be part of it, okay? If you have one weak link, for instance, you might have a remote worker who never, ever comes to the office, never really came in, never got an email account, you never really put them through the right onboarding, perhaps, and now they're accessing your client's information with their personal Gmail account. Probably you think, I've done that. Has anyone else done that? Use their personal account for work? Two? Okay, I'm gonna assume there's more than two. But it's a bad thing. But do you have a policy for that when you hire somebody or when you're working with somebody? Do you say, if you want to work with us, you need to follow this set list of things? Most small companies don't, so I definitely recommend you do that. A corporate email address is just one example of that. If you use Google Drive to share data, it's really easy in Drive to limit access to digital assets by corporate email. So you can say everyone in my organization with the same domain name, if they're on their browser with that, logged in with that account, then they can access or they can't access. But there are other, of course, softwares depending on how you manage assets and stuff. So keep that in mind when you're developing your own one. We all share a Netflix account probably with somebody. Don't do that at work. That's just for home, right, obviously. The other thing a lot of people overlook is disaster planning. And disasters come in all shapes and sizes, big and small. Could be something as a data center going out, or recently there was a very large denial of service attack on DIN, right? Facebook was down, Twitter was down. This was about 2 months ago, I think. What is your disaster plan if you have issues at your agency? All your sites go out. Who does what? When do they do it? Who calls who, right? What is the emergency contact info? It might not be a server emergency, because that's kind of one of the, or like say a bunch of hacked websites. Could be a physical disaster. Could be a bad storm. Could be a flood, okay? You need to know where your people are and how to get a hold of them, you know, especially if this happens during work hours. For IT related specifically, what is your server provider info? If your computer where you have your group password manager goes down, how do you get in and say adjust your DNS if you have to redirect traffic somewhere? If you're under attack by, you know, a botnet, you've got to redirect that DNS to get kind of back control over your servers. How do you do that if you've had some kind of catastrophe? That applies to your hosting or your servers, data centers, backups. Could be all kinds of things depending on the infrastructure you have at your agency. And two-factor authentication, I'm sure most of you are using that already. That's where you have two different pieces of information to log in. So pretty common these days are to have your email address and password as one factor, and then either a dongle with a code or a code that gets sent to you by text message, for example, that as a second piece to log in. All those services have one-time use backup passwords, and those are things that you need stored digitally, generally, in your password manager to keep it secure, but also somewhere physically. And I mentioned earlier in your safe deposit box, we physically have a safe deposit box for that purpose. And we keep our codes in there once a year. We update them in case there's some disaster, okay? Here's another part that we often skip over, and that's ongoing education for people in our agency. When we come out with something new, or we change a workflow, or new technologies come up, or new threats, do the people in our agency, are they cognizant of such things? If there's a new phishing scam coming out on email, do we have a way to tell our team members that to watch out for that when they get mail in their account? So again, email is just a really easy example to talk about here. If you go to a website called Phishing Box, what you do is you hire them to test your agency for their susceptibility to phishing attacks. So they will generate a mock attack, send it to the people that you indicate, you know, by email, you give them a list of email addresses, and then they measure how many people click through and fall for the phishing attack. They give you that information, and then you get to bring it up at your next meeting, right? And that's it sounds a little deceptive, but frankly, keeping everyone's mind on the fact that digital threats are escalating and more common, we feel that's good, okay? You can be transparent, of course, and let people know that those things are coming. It's kind of like a fire drill at school. Knowing that you're going to have a couple a year, you know, let you know to be prepared, okay? And so that's kind of how we look at that. So I recommend that if you don't have one, to prepare one. And if you do have one, review it regularly. And by that, I mean a security policy. Talk about things like email usage, access to resources, password strength, password duration. What's the duration that you keep passwords? Once a client rolls off your billing cycle, how long do you keep their credentials for when they're no longer going to be a customer? Right? You should have a retention policy for that information, okay? Because you don't want to be someone pointing the finger at you 5 years down the road, hey, didn't you have that password back then? Do you still have it? Could someone have stolen it from your computer? You don't want to be answering those questions. You want to point them to your policy and the documentation that says, oh, sorry, sir, we deleted all your data 4 years ago on this date, and here's our audit of that information, okay? Team composition, disaster planning, and ongoing education. So those are all things that I recommend you think about when you're considering or building your own security policy. So now we're going to get a little more technical. And if things start to get, I know we have some beginners in the room or at least attending today. So if things are starting to sound a little wonky, I've got a couple slides for you at the end of this little part. So don't get discouraged. So we talk about our server and services. We talk about, these are our infrastructure pieces upon which we build, say, our WordPress site or whatever kind of project we're building for our clients. And we break them down into local resources and remote resources. So local resources are the things that you maintain either on site or at your data center or with your hosting provider, for example. And remote are services that someone else is maintaining and perhaps you're buying and using them in the cloud. Okay? So we think about the local resources. Most of the websites probably that you guys work on are built on some kind of AMP stack, some Apache, MySQL, and PHP stack with Linux or Unix or some version of that. Okay, all these things are software running on your server. And if we take PHP as an example, this is the current PHP usage for WordPress installs, WordPress.org installs. Okay, self-hosted WordPress. So who knows what the current supported versions of PHP are? Somebody here does.
5, 6, and 7.
Now, there are two versions of 7, but they're both supported. I combined them because almost no one's on 7.01 or 0.1, whatever it is. So it's really just these two here. So about 37% of WordPress sites, self-hosted WordPress sites, are using a currently supported version of PHP. All the rest below are end of life. Security updates are not being put out for that, and hosts, some hosts, the good hosts, will be kind of patching them for you, but really the best thing, of course, is for you to be at 5.6, which I believe goes end of life, end of 2018, but with the speed increases in PHP 7, start testing your applications for compatibility, upwards compatibility now, so that when PHP 5.6 goes end of life, you can migrate there more smoothly. You don't want to be at an end of life situation and realize that half of the plugins on your WordPress site don't support it. I think we're getting closer to that now than we were 6 months ago, but these softwares on our infrastructure also need to be updated and maintained, okay? Well-known errors occur in these softwares, like most people are running Apache or Nginx web servers. And has anyone heard of the Heartbleed bug? I mean, it must be quite a few people heard of that, right? So this is a bug in the protocol on your server that provides the SSL communication between your website and the end user so that it encrypts your communications. And there was a pretty important bug there last year, and they actually came up with a Heartbleed checker, and you can just check your own website right now at that address, and that'll tell you if it's that server is compatible to this SSL problem. Even if your website itself isn't running HTTPS, you can still check if your server is going to be vulnerable to this, because if that server gets affected, depending on how your host has set up their environment, your site could be vulnerable also. Okay, so even if you're not running HTTPS, you definitely want to check if you're falling on, if your server might be susceptible to this kind of Heartbleed bug. Other local issues that you should worry about, or you might worry about, whether or not you're running SSH on the non-default port. Normally there's a default port for running SSH communication. It's a good best practice not to use that default and to customize something for you specifically. Disabling non-secure FTP, using strong database passwords, and that goes back to our password strength conversation. It should be unique and strong. But also, you want a custom table prefix. So when you install a new Joomla, install a new WordPress site, of course, your database has a prefix in there, and there's a default. You don't want to use that default, and most of the security tools you might be using already probably have told you that already. Enable logging. This is at the server level again. Most shared hosts will not enable logging by default because it's more resources for them and more storage for them. You have to manually go in, and if they've let you, enable logging back in the cPanel or Plesk backend or whatever you're using to manage your hosting account. Logging is only important when you need it the most, okay? Most of the time, you don't care. But when your site gets hacked and you're wondering what the source was, if you've not enabled logging, you've missed the chance to track down and find the problem. If you turn on logging after the hack, you've missed the chance. Now, I should just say that it's not a golden solution because the really, really good hackers will delete the logs on the way out after they've hacked your site. So it's not always great, but for sure, if it's off, you have no chance. So turn on the logging. And magic quotes is another thing that is kind of, that's more of an older legacy type tip, I guess you'd say. Okay, so that's local issues. Okay, but there's also remote issues. In today's modern, on any modern website, really, you have lots of integrated services in general, or at least one. I mean, Google Analytics, most people have something like that on their website, right? So that's an example of a remote service that you need to make sure is safe. At our consultancy, we don't actually run email on our servers, on our web servers. So we have all the email segregated to transactional email service providers. Some of you, especially large organizations, would have a separate mail server, which would also serve a similar purpose. But if you're a smaller agency and you're going to send, you know, 100,000 or less emails from, not from, I'm not talking about your work email, but your website's going to send 100,000 or fewer emails. This might be for all your clients. That'd be more than enough for most small agencies. Then I recommend you just outsource that to something. We love SparkPost, by the way. So you might have heard of Mandrill in the past, Mailgun. There's all kinds of transactional email service providers. I have tried them all, and you should also, but I highly recommend SparkPost. We pay $20 a month for a dedicated IP address. That really reduces any spam issues we have. We get 100,000 emails with that a month, and we have no one interested in our web servers as a potential source of sending email spam, right? Because that's a big, what's one of the big interest areas for spammers and hackers. So it doesn't have to be SparkPost, but I must say I've been very impressed with them. The other thing that we use as a remote service, a critical remote service, is a remote DNS provider. Of course, DNS is what converts your domain to your IP address so that you can deliver the content that is associated with that domain, the right content when the user requests it. Now, many of you, who's using cPanel? This is a quick show of hands. cPanel? Lots, right? Pretty common, the most common back end. Oftentimes, when you create a new account, it says, oh, what name servers would you like? And you generally have a name server running on your shared host. That's really great until your host goes down, your server goes down, because it's really convenient. But the problem is, when your server's down, you can't change it. So if you have some catastrophic event, you can't reroute that traffic somewhere. Maybe load your site on a backup server from a backup that you have stored off-site. You can't do any of that if your domain server is on the same server as your web server, or your mail server, and your mail server gets hacked, then you can't do that. So I recommend that you look for ways to outsource that, or at least put it on a separate server with a different kind of a different access and not in the same node as your web server. So we use Cloudflare, which has a lot of other benefits. I'll mention them a little later. One really great feature, even if you think all the security stuff is my site's too small, nobody cares. The really great thing is, if you do make a change in the IP address, it's about 10-second propagation time through Cloudflare. And so you don't have to wait for that next day, let's see if it's done and all that stuff. If you can change it literally moment to moment and look at the effects on your, on your work, depending on what you're doing. So in terms of development, when you're in a development stage, we find it super, super helpful. Or, when you're switching, another good example, when you're switching from development to we're going live, then you don't have to wait the day either. You switch it, it's on, your client's happy, and you can see if you have any errors and get moving. So we really like Cloudflare, and it's free, by the way. The DNS part is free. There are many, many free features, so I recommend that or another kind of DNS provider. I said earlier, if all those technical things sounded a little bit maybe above your interest level, you can consider, I don't really like to recommend hosts. There are lots of good hosts. There are a lot more poor hosts in terms of security. But if you really don't care about managing those things like your LAMP stack and DNS, all that stuff, consider a hosted platform, a hosted server. These are more expensive. They're going to run you maybe tenfold more than what you could get at a low-end shared hosting. WP Engine and Pagely are the big ones. Scott, are there some other ones? Because I know you guys are experts in this.
Flywheel,
right, that's another big one. So those are more expensive services, but you get a lot with them. You get really advanced caching, a lot of patching of security issues as they come in, which we'll talk about in a moment. But they're, if you're passing on the price and your client doesn't mind, then I guess you don't mind either. But so I'm just going to, I have no affiliation with those organizations, by the way. So the last thing I'm going to talk to you about is sites and software. So this is the very kind of top of our pyramid. If we have a strong group policy at our agency and then we have really good secure hardware, now we can focus on the things we're using daily, and that's usually the application, in this case, WordPress, its themes and its plugins. And the very, very easiest first thing you should do every day if you're in your back end is update everything. WordPress makes it super easy. If you have many sites, There are services that also make it easy to do this in bulk. The core is generally for a modern WordPress site updated for you, but the plugins are not. Now, I don't really recommend that you auto-update the plugins. You can automate that with plugins, ironically. So I don't really recommend that because they can break your site, especially if you have customizations. But you want to be keeping your eye on the plugin and theme updates very, very closely, okay? So we set a schedule that we update, you know, every Friday. We have different tiers of clients, but for our top tier, every Friday is update day, and we start out Thursday, and we do all our updates. Post-update, we do all the tests because we want to make sure the sites still work, and then hopefully nothing went wrong, but if it did, you have about 24 hours before the weekend so you can fix it before you take off. So that's also important to have a good balance. So definitely update. I showed you the data earlier. Out-of-date software is probably the largest factor for WordPress plugins. It's so easy these days. Really got to hand it to WordPress for working hard at making sure those updates work well. There are other number of known best practices that we could talk about. I don't want to go into them a lot. I should say that if you've not done this, listen up and do this like in the next hour or two. Go search for the top WordPress security best practices on Google. You probably find 10,000 blog posts on that. Pick the top five, and you're going to get some really good advice. Okay, I don't need to reiterate those for you because there's so much out there. But just briefly, a couple of things: unique administrator account. Some of these again are legacy type things. You want to disable file editing and PHP execution. Limit the number of login attempts so you can't just have a brute force attack. This is a big one. If you remove your unused themes and plugins, for one, you have less to update, and two, there's just fewer vectors for people to use to try and gain access to your site or try and attack your site. And block editing of the config file. You don't want people getting in there looking at your hashes and the other things you might have in there, your database password and stuff like that. So those are kind of some of the basics. I think many people have probably heard of some of those. There's not really a good way to enforce strong passwords in WordPress. They do have a password strength indicator, right, when you make a user, but they don't enforce a certain strength level. So there's not really a really great comprehensive plugin where you can set a password strength level that is acceptable for a new user, for example, but you can set some things in there. So you can have a look at this plugin and see if that helps. If you have a lot of new users, this is helpful, or people, I run a nonprofit sports group website, and their users just cannot remember the passwords ever. And so they are hitting that reset password a lot. So this comes in handy for us for keeping things safe and secure. In the general settings, you can control access. If you don't have a membership site, this should be unselected in your WordPress settings. There's no reason, this is an option for membership in the WordPress settings. There's no reason to give a potential attacker, or pardon me, a hacker, a reason to create a new user on your site. Because if they make that user and they can escalate the privileges to be an administrator, then they can really start messing around in your site. You do not want that, obviously. So unless you truly need new members signing up on the front end of your site, just leave that disabled. There's also the new user default role. So you might say, oh, Vic, I'm not letting membership, so it doesn't matter what this setting is. Well, again, if someone can get access to even a low level, you know, a hack that may not take your site down but gives them a little bit of access and they can manage to create a user, if the default of this is administrator, now they've got a lot of access. So it's just good policy that even if you've disabled membership, to keep the new user default roles at lowest privileges possible, which is obviously subscriber. WordPress and Joomla, I'll say that word intentionally for the first time, they give you a lot of information when you try and log in and you've made an error. They say something like, that username doesn't exist. Or they say, I'm sorry, that password user combination is not valid. Something along those lines. And the issue is that tells a potential hacker or attacker that they've got one or the other wrong. If they can figure out they've got a proper username, it's much easier for them to perform a brute force entry attack on your site. So you can easily, You can easily, by modifying functions.php, just add a little bit of code in there that means if they give the wrong username, Or they give the wrong password, they just see the same message, wrong username or password. It doesn't give them the extra information that they have got one thing wrong. So again, you're just de-incentivizing people of coming in and attacking your site, okay? I have all these slides online. I'll provide a link at the end, so don't worry about writing down this really ugly, long URL. I'm sorry it's so long. You can get all these online, all these slides. Okay, so I should have had the slide a little earlier. Don't update your site until you've got a backup, and make sure you back up your site every X frequency, depending on your usage. If you have a static site, probably once a week or once a month is enough. If you have an active site with lots of new content and things like that, then you want to be doing nightly or even by, you know, two backups a day, for example. So there are lots of backup solutions. And so, you know, although I've used WordPress for years, I've not used it heavily except for maybe the last 2 years. And I can't tell you which of these is best. Someone told me that Backup Buddy was super popular. Who's using Backup Buddy as their backup solution? So I wouldn't say super popular. Who's using Updraft Plus? Well, not different. So there's a lot of backup solutions. This appears to be the most popular on the plugin directory. Backup Buddy's not on there. Does anyone know why that is? Because I've been asking every WordPress person I know why that's not on the directory. So if you know, tell me later, please. I would love to know. But you need to pick one of these if you're not already doing it. And if your host is doing backups for you, you also need to do this. Okay? Essentially, we go by this policy. Unless you have the backup in your hands and you've verified it, you may as well not have a backup. That's our policy, okay? And having redundant backups, it certainly doesn't hurt, right? And if you can automate it, all of these have automated backups, that's great. And then they have automated offsite storage. So you can be storing your backup files on Amazon S3, Dropbox, Microsoft OneDrive, is that what it's called? Or remote FTP server. There are lots of options for you to send these backup files. We use, for legacy reasons, something called Akiba Backup, and that's also not on the plugin directory, which is frustrating. But they have a really interesting option. So you can see here we're backing up to Amazon S3. And there's this thing called an archive integrity check. So people who make a backup software will tell you every time you make a backup, you need to test the backup. Because if it's corrupted or it's not complete, you're not going to be able to restore your information. Who's going to be restoring backups every day? That's not something I can do and kind of have a healthy, happy life. So we really like this option in Akiba Backup because if it can't verify its own integrity, it sends you a message so you know there's something wrong with the backup, okay? You also, in our recommendation, should use a series of redundant firewalls, okay? There's no one that does it all. There's not one that's best. Jetpack obviously has lots of features. The free version includes basic malicious attack prevention. Okay, doesn't provide file scanning or things like that, but essentially that's sanitizing the requests on the website through, you know, WordPress's, you know, very large, obviously, database of known attack vectors. So that's obviously, you know, the free version is easy to install, and you can whitelist certain IP addresses, for instance, of your office so that you never get locked out, that sort of thing. And there's of course, that's on by default, blocking the malicious login attempts, okay? So definitely recommend Jetpack. The other one that we recommend is the all-in-one WP Security and Firewall. You might have your own favorite firewall. Feel free to insert that here, okay? We certainly like this one. One thing about this firewall and the other ones, there are a few others that are in this kind of class of, you know, high feature, you know, block everything kind of firewall. One thing is you have to find a balance for your agency, and this might be part of your security policy. We talked about that earlier. What balance do you need to give security, but people can still log in and do what they need to do, okay? I'm getting the signal from Scott, and I'm almost done. Thank you for your attention. This is actually a live screen or a screenshot from one of our sites, and we're at about almost not quite half of what we could get. The top score in this extension for locking your site down is 470. We're at about 200. For us, that balance makes sense. Your balance might be 100. It might be 350, but you're going to have to figure out what exactly that is for you, okay? And I mentioned Cloudflare earlier. Cloudflare has a host of features, and you can see them all listed here. There's the DNS one I mentioned earlier. They also have a firewall area, and it's much like we mentioned earlier with Jetpack sanitizing any requests before it lets kind of an attacker in. So that's another really great reason to be using Cloudflare. And that's basically, for every site we run, we have those three firewalls, Jetpack, all-in-one security, WP security, and Cloudflare. That's the end of my talk. As I said, my slides are currently here. You can get all the links that you want. Feel free to contact me if you have any security questions or anything else you'd like to ask me. I'd love to hear from you. Thank you very much.
We have a couple minutes for questions and answers if you want to ask anything.
Actually, can you tell me the link of your slides out loud?
It's a bit.ly link, so it's bit.ly/WCW2017-security.
Awesome, thank you.
You're welcome. Yes?
You mentioned early on when you were talking about the ransomware that if somebody has WordPress on the computer and they have an outdated browser.
Right, so this ransomware is not specific for WordPress, but there was a botnet involving a bunch of WordPress sites that were already infected with something else that was spreading this problem. What happened was when you went to the site, it redirected you. Instead of going to the WordPress site you wanted, it redirected you to somewhere else. And that would actually take a hold of either a Flash defect or a Microsoft Silverlight defect from an outdated browser. And it would use that exploit to download some other nasty stuff, rootkits, and really take over your PC. So it was a multi-layered, very complex attack to figure out, also very hard to solve, because you could fix it and then still go back to the same website and get it again. So in that case, it required an outdated, infected botnet of WordPress sites and outdated plugins in your browser.
Thank you.
Okay. Oh, one more. Sorry. Oh, two more. Go ahead. That your site is attacked or that there's some, for instance, vulnerable software?
Yeah, I mean, a girlfriend of mine had an attack with some Islamic stuff painted on it. I mean, is there a place to report that?
So that's it sounds like a basic defacing attack. So you would report it first to your host or IT provider. And then if you identify the cause, say it was a certain plugin, then you could identify the plugin, contact the plugin author. That's what I'd recommend. Exactly right. Yep. Someone had told me about Backup Buddy that was really popular. I couldn't verify it, actually. That's why I was asking. You have to pay for Updraft Premium, so of course that's not on the directory. But I wouldn't know why it would get so popular. So maybe it's just not that popular.
I don't think they have the free version.
They don't have it, right.
I think that's why.
If they don't have a free version, they're not allowed to be on that.
Exactly right. So I'm not surprised that. I'm more. If they did have a free version to get popular, why did they take it off? Yeah. Yes? Exactly right. Manage WP. My time is up. Thank you very much.